We're partnering with NOCD to raise awareness about OCD. OCD is more than what you see on TV and in the movies. Imagine having unwanted thoughts about your relationship stuck in your head all day, no matter how hard you try to make them go away. That's relationship OCD. It comes with unrelenting, intrusive images, thoughts, and urges about your partner or loved one. If you think you may be struggling with relationship OCD, there's hope. NOCD offers effective, affordable, and convenient OCD therapy. NOCD therapists are trained in exposure response prevention therapy, the gold standard treatment for OCD. With NOCD, you can do virtual live face-to-face video sessions with one of their licensed specialty trained therapists. It's affordable and they accept most major insurance plans. Breaking the relationship OCD cycle takes effective treatment. To get started with NOCD, go to nocd.com/dateable to book a free 15-minute call. Hi, I'm Yui Shu.
And I'm Julie Kraftchick.
We're active daters turned dating sociologists.
Here to dive into everything modern dating and relationships.
Welcome to the Dateable Podcast. Hi, friends. Welcome to another episode. Are you all full from Thanksgiving? Are you all wearing elastic waist pants?
I am.
Which is what I live in.
Is it a problem if that's what you were doing before Thanksgiving?
No, not at all. Not at all. That's like all I own. Now when I see pants with buttons, I'm like, ooh, why? Why would you do that to yourself?
I feel like I have to replace my workout pants. And I'm not saying that as someone that's always working out. It's just what I live in now, basically. You know, like I do. Okay, so I do Stitch Fix. This is not sponsored by Stitch Fix. This is my personal thing, although they would be a great sponsor.
Oh, we would love to be sponsored. Yes.
I love it because I'm super lazy in shopping. I used to love shopping, like love it. Like growing up, my grandmother was like that was her hobby, basically shopping. And I loved it. And somewhere along the lines, I just lost it completely. And this shirt I'm wearing now is from Stitch Fix.
Cute.
But what's great about it is that they just send you stuff in the mail. You don't have to think about it. But I was saying the other day that I have like way too many sweaters and jeans from them now. And I was like, oh, maybe I should just cancel. And then I was like, I need to actually just redo the quiz or whatever and be like all athleisure because that's all I need.
Yeah, exactly. Like get the staples that you live in. Like what are jeans? Like why? Why do people wear jeans?
Well, I feel like the staples, like the yoga pants I wear, the problem is because I wear them so frequently, they start to like wear down because they're not like nice. I'm not like getting Lululemon and like top tier brands. And I wore one the other day and I wore it out. My partner was like, you should not be in public in that. Because they were like completely like wore down on one side. I'm like, I'm out of pants.
Oh my gosh. When your partner tells you you should be wearing those pants, you know it's a dire situation.
It's true, especially a guy.
I've also lost my interest in shopping just because it's such a pain in the ass, like to go out there and be around people. So I do online shopping, but online shopping is such a crapshoot. You know, shit
it is. That's
you.
The problem with it.
Yeah.
It's kind of annoying.
So I do a lot of returns.
You're more stylish, though. I feel like at least in LA, I mean, you probably experienced this moving from SF to LA, but it seems drastic.
Drastic.
SF fashion goes to die.
Yeah, SF fashion, there's like a uniform, basically. And you're like, oh, I can just wear this all the time. But
yoga pants.
Yeah, yoga pants, fleece.
Sweatshirt.
You're good. Company issued logoed sweatshirts. Yeah, you're good. Here, it's like if you do wear that, then you got to wear like something really crazy on the bottom. You know, it's like part of an outfit. It's a look. Like a Google hoodie with like ripped leather pants or something.
Oh my God. Taking it, then it's no longer fun anymore.
Yeah, no. We, you know, that's all to say that that's nothing related to this episode we're about to, this interview.
I was like, it kind of, is I don't know, you know, appearance,
reality TV.
I don't know. There's a stretch. There's always a stretch if you find one.
Sure.
Like your pants.
Reality TV. We talk to the girls from Two Black Girls, One Rose, who have this amazing podcast all about reality TV. They break it down. They do the summaries. They talk about some of the hottest shows out there. And they take it to a whole new level. Like Julie and I can talk about Love is Blind for hours, but they can talk about it for
hours. Like,
and they could talk about all of them, not just Love is Blind, like the whole gamut of reality TV.
And I was kind of thinking about this, reflecting back on this episode, is on one hand, we can critique reality TV for shaping our reality, so to speak. But on the other hand, reality TV is a mirror, a reflection back of what's going on in modern dating. And sometimes when you look back and when it's reflected back at you, it's alarming. You're like, oh shit, this is a shit that's going on in real life. It's not just for the drama.
I'm really glad that we did this crossover. We were also on their podcast, Justine and Natasha. Those are the hosts of Two Black Girls, One Rose. And we were on their podcast to talk about the pick me mentality. You know, like that, I want to be chosen at all costs. Mm-hmm. And you see that on reality TV. It's like, will I get this next rose? Will I progress to the next round? But we also see that in dating culture, because how many times have we heard from people, I just want to get to the next date. I just want to get that text back. I just want to DTR. And sometimes we don't stop and say, like, do I even like this person that I'm working overtime to get their attention?
Yeah.
And I'm really glad we did this crossover, because UA and I were clearly able to bring our expertise on modern dating. And they were like, oh, we hadn't thought about it this way. And then they brought their deep dive knowledge about reality TV. And we were like, yeah, we hadn't connected those dots. So, you know, obviously check out us on their podcast too. But this is a great episode. It made me think about reality TV a little differently. And we're not saying that reality TV mimics dating 100%, but it is interesting to see the parallels.
I thought you were going to say, and we brought our expertise on reality TV as well, which is true. I mean, we do. Between Julie and I think we've got some, like, the popular reality shows covered. I'm so glad I recently turned her to Bachelor in Paradise, which is my favorite show, and I will stand by that. It's so good.
I admit that I have not been a big proponent of the Bachelor
franchise. Me neither. I like it.
There was a period.
There was a period. Yes. Like 8 years ago. Yes.
Yeah. And I was like, oh, I don't know about this. And I actually am a recent convert to reality TV dating shows. Love is Blind is what did it for me. There was something about that show that made me really like get hooked on it. And my partner still doesn't believe me, because I always tell him, like, I never really watched this that much. Yes, thank you. You are vouching for me. But he's like, yeah, right. You're always watching reality dating shows. And I'm like, now I am. Yes.
Yeah, I can say 7 years ago, 5 years ago, you were not this Julie that I know today. I'm so glad that you've come to the dark side.
I've gone to trash TV world. I've converted.
But it's still, they're all social experiments, and these are still real people on these shows. So yes, some of it's contrived and scripted, but there are still reactions that you find very relatable. You know, when the insecurities come out, I find those moments so relatable, because you find that in everyday dating. You know, that's what happens. The one part, I'm going to tie it back to your Stitch Fix conversation.
The one part, can tie everything back.
That is a skill we have. The one part I do not find relatable at all to reality TV is the amount of makeup and the outfits that they don on these shows. How many hours are they getting ready before they go on camera? Because the cameras start rolling at like 6 a.m. So are they up at like 3, putting on their lashes, putting on their nails, putting on their fucking face? Like, this is so not relatable.
Well, especially Love is Blind, when the first part of the show, they're not even seeing the people.
But they're like,
I mean, clearly they're on camera.
They're
I get
in
it.
Full cocktail dresses.
Yeah. If this was real dating and I wasn't seeing anyone, actually, this was kind of COVID, right?
Yeah.
Like, you were doing a lot of dates on the phone. I love phone over video, because I'm like, permission to not get ready at all.
Yes.
You know, permission to be in my pajamas doing a date. Amazing.
But if you're going to try to be your truest, most authentic self, wouldn't you be lounging in your PJs and you just like bedhead? I don't know. That's the part that's a disconnect for me, because that's not reality. Yeah. It reminds me of the scene, was it in Bridesmaids, when she wakes up next to the guy, but she goes and gets ready first, like puts on makeup and then comes back to bed. It's like, oh, I just woke up like this. That's what it reminds me of. It's so, it's like so not real.
I feel like there's been multiple scenes in TV shows that do that. Like Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, they had one too. But okay, there is a little bit of reality in this though, right? Like when we go on dates, I don't know about you. I wear more. I'm not putting the levels of makeup as these people, but I wear more makeup than I normally do. Okay, before COVID times, I always wore a dress to dates.
Mm-hmm.
What? How often do I wear a dress ever?
Exactly. Exactly.
So we're always kind of putting our best face forward.
I know.
For dates.
I know. In some ways, I get it. It's a respect thing. You're showing that you respect yourself and you respect the person you're with. So you're putting a little bit more effort. That part I agree with. But to go out there and wear the amount of makeup or to wear the outfit that you would not ever wear, and it's only a date outfit or a date makeup, that's a little misleading for me,
right?
I think
so.
But we all do it. All of us do it.
We all do
it. I used to wear like the 4-inch stilettos to dates. I'm like, when else would I ever wear it? Why would I torture myself in this? This is such a fucking bait and switch because he's going to get in a relationship with me and I'm going to be in sneakers like all the time.
So I kind of got like nostalgic about dating the other day because like one of my friends was telling me how her like sister is back dating and, you know, meeting people. And I'm like, oh, there's like a part of me that misses that, right? Like never knowing what's around the corner, what the night will hold. It's fun. It's exciting. But the part of dating that is not is this, right? The presentation and this like feeling like I need to impress someone. And I think this is what makes dating so painful because it's so unnatural. Like I love dating in COVID when I just showed up at the park in my yoga attire because that was natural and I felt comfortable and I was more focused on making a connection with someone than how I looked and how I was presenting. And I feel like we get so caught in this stuff that we lose track of like, why are we actually trying to date in the first place?
Yes, because we're trying to create the reality TV environment on these first couple dates, but they're not real because the camera stopped rolling at some point and that face is going to come off at some point. So we got to find a good balance. A few weeks ago, I went on a date with this guy and he said, do you want this date to be casual or do you want this to be like date? And I said, let's keep it chill and casual. So we had a really chill like t-shirt and jeans night. And I kind of appreciated that there was a choice and he was able to think about the two different scenarios. So that's an option.
Look at you, A, back out there.
I know. Did I just reveal I'm back out there? But I was like, whoa, is this how dating works now? Like you get a choice between two different scenarios. It's great.
Well, I remember like when I was, you know, in the thick of being super single, I remember going to brunch with our friend Kiana and she was just like, I wish there was like this radically honest date where you could just like lay out everything on the table, just like past traumas, all the deal, like everything that's happens, you just get super real with the person. And it's like, in theory, I do really like that idea, but then it never comes off right because this person is a stranger, right? And then it just comes off as trauma dumping. But I do think like we try to be someone we're not so often, and that's what gets in the way.
Yep. I used to go on first dates with like a story in mind, you know, a persona. Like today I'm going to be a flirty dance instructor, UA.
Oh, God.
Right? And then I'm going to come in with a story about like a student
that's
in my
so
class.
Reality TV.
So reality TV. And like, yeah, my date would be entertained, but then at the same time, be like, who the fuck are you? You just came in hot with all these stories and this like this persona about you. Yeah, I was so fucked up.
Oh my God. If anyone is a new listener, you need to go back to the archives. I'm going to link it in the show notes of this one. Just
outing
so it's
me.
Easy for people. But there is one episode we did back in the day. You know what I'm talking about. It was called Dating on a Whim because there was a dating app whim back then that is no
that
longer in existence.
Months,
And you ain't put it out of business. I'm just kidding.
We did the opposite for them. Of what they hoped would happen.
No, it was actually like, I think the best thing that happened for you though, because you went in thinking like slaying the date, entertainer, what you just said, basically like I'm the persona and the guy that was like, I just want you to be real. Like, why are you doing this? And it was the wake up call.
He's like, that's nice and all, but who are you? Like halfway through that, he's like, who are you?
But I do actually, I guess in the vein of reality TV, I love doing those type of episodes when we've done them because we basically, we had UA and him go on a date and then we interviewed both of them. And it is the social experiment. It's the same thing that is drawing us to reality TV is just like living and seeing people interact as like this third party. It's like you're almost like getting this, like the spy vision intrusion into someone's life.
If you look at any reality dating show, it's the same progression. The first couple dates, the conversation's like flirty and kind of performative, you know, oh my God, I'm so into my nieces and nephews. I love seeing them for holidays. I bring them all these. It's like, oh, it's that God. Kind of that tone too.
It's like you haven't talked to your niece and nephew in like,
yeah, months. Like what are their names? Can you name them? Yeah. And then when insecurities come out, that's when the voice, the tone of the voice drops. You go to a lower octave, you start speaking much quieter, and then the conversation's more about like, I don't know where this is going. I don't know how I feel about this person. That's the authenticity. But every reality show goes through that progression. Same with dating. The first couple dates, it's like, yeah, I went to school here and I grew up here and I love the snow and I love to hike. Da, 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 da. It's up. Everything is like light, light, light. And then when someone doesn't call you back or there's like some ghosting happening, your voice drops. It's like, I don't know what the fuck happened. That's the real you. That's the real. How do we get to that faster? That's always been my question. How do we like fast forward to that?
I just like, who made up? I mean, some of it's the rules in bad dating books, but I feel like it goes further. It's like someone back in the day decided like, this is how dating works and we must do these progressions and steps and present this way. Like, how did that even get started?
Yeah, it must be somebody who studied first impressions and said, this is how you make a first good impression. Do you remember? Maybe you don't remember, Julie. Maybe this is like, because we're a few years apart, maybe this all died by the time entered the job force. But when I was interviewing for jobs after college, I had to wear full suits. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
But that was taught to me in college. Like when we did on-campus job interviews, we were all told to buy full fucking suits to wear. And now looking back is like, what, unless you worked on Wall Street, what job would you wear a full fucking suit? It's the same thing with dating. It's like, why are you, if you're interviewing for this job, why are you acting and presenting yourself in a way that you would never act in that job?
Well, I remember I brought all my suits when I moved to San Francisco, and I quickly realized that I looked like a complete and utter fool here because
that's good to know.
Everything is so casual here, right? Like people would show up in the hoodie and you're in a full suit. Like you looked ridiculous, but it gives me a little hope for dating.
Yeah.
Because maybe as a culture, we're getting there, right? Of saying like, you don't need to put on this front.
Yeah, we're getting there.
I don't know.
Okay.
Okay. Well, we could go on all day, but we got a full episode for you with Justine and Natasha. So excited to bring that to you at Dateable Podcast. That's where you find us. Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, everywhere. We're all over the place. We are still changing the name of the Dateable Facebook group from Love in the Time of Corona to something else. We have not forgotten about it. We're just trying to find that right name. Still a discussion, but it's happening. Don't worry. But for now, you can find us there too.
Yes.
Okay, announcements. So our Finding Your Person program is still open. We are so excited for everyone that's already joined. We had a good amount of people that are already locked into the program, but we still have a few spots left. Registration is going to close on Sunday the 3rd. So you have until then to get your spot.
Unless we reach capacity beforehand, which has happened in the past.
True.
And that happens, we'll have to close the registration. So the moral of the story is sign up sooner than later because you may miss your chance.
Yep. And if you're brand new and you have no idea what Finding Your Person is, or FYP, we can call it for short, it is our flagship program that we've been running now for 3 years. I think we've been doing it for quite some bit. We've had different cohorts. We probably should start naming these cohorts, but we have had multiple cohorts go through this. We love doing this program. It's all self-paced audio, digital workbooks, and then you also get 2 check-ins with the 2 of us. So we love to see your progress throughout, and there's also a bunch of bonuses you receive too. So we love this program, and we're excited to offer it again.
Get on it.
Hey, and if you want to register, go to findingyourperson.com. Okay, well, before we keep going, let's hear a message from our sponsors. This episode is brought to you by Uncommon Goods. The holidays are nearing, and if you're looking for high quality, meaningful, out of the ordinary gifts, then look no further. From art and jewelry to kitchen, home and bar, Uncommon Goods has something for everyone. Not the same lackluster gifts that you could find just anywhere. I may have pulled the trigger and got my mom this adorable book nook since she's such an avid reader, but hopefully she's not listening because that might ruin the surprise. And don't tell anyone, but I might have gifted some of their jewelry because I was really digging their birth month flower heart necklaces. So cute. There are so many options at Uncommon Goods that make for unique gifts for your entire shopping list. And remember, with every purchase you make at Uncommon Goods, they give back $1 to a nonprofit partner of your choice. They've donated more than $2.5 million to date. To get 15% off your next gift, go to uncommongoods.com/dateable. That's uncommongoods.com/dateable for 15% off. Don't miss out on this limited time offer. Uncommon Goods, we're all out of the ordinary. This episode is brought to you by Factor. It can be hard to find time to cook your everyday meals at the end of the year, especially when your calendar is jam-packed with holiday plans. And from all the holiday cooking, sometimes you just want a meal that's convenient. Factor is America's number one ready-to-eat meal delivery service that delivers chef-prepared, dietitian-approved meals straight to your door. I loved how I could skip that extra trip to the grocery store and how these fresh, never-frozen meals were ready in 2 minutes. I didn't realize how much time I was saving by not having to chop, prep, and clean. Not to mention, I was really digging this sausage and pasta dish, and my partner loved his jalapeno chicken dish because he loves spicy things. The best part, too, is the meals felt healthy. And normally when I'm busy, I may resort to takeout a little too often. This November, get Factor and enjoy eating well without the hassle. Head to factormeals.com/dateable50 and use the code dateable50 to get 50% off. That's code dateable50 at factormeals.com/dateable50 to get 50% off. Okay, let's hear it from Justine and Natasha.
Reality TV shows, specifically dating shows, would have to be one of my favorite pastimes ever on a Tuesday or a Wednesday or any day that ends with a Y. And I love that our guests today have an entire podcast dedicated to reality shows. We've got Justine and Natasha from Two Black Girls, One Rose podcast talking about how reality dating shows have really shaped the way we look at modern dating, love, and relationships. Welcome to Dateable, ladies. Thanks for being here.
Welcome.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us. Excited to chat.
We are so excited.
Who is Natasha? She's 33 years old, lives in New York City, originally from New Jersey, but with Jamaican roots, and she is married. And then we've also got Justine. She's 33 years old, from Jersey City, originally from New Jersey. She's African-American, and she's in a monogamous relationship. Okay, why do you think we're all so perplexed by reality TV shows? What is the draw there, and why are we so invested in them? We can start with Natasha.
Sure. I think reality dating as a genre really speaks to so many people, I think, because everyone understands love. Everybody has a relationship to love, whether you're single or married or dating. Like, everyone has some feelings and opinions about the world of dating and relationships and love. It connects with everyone. And I think reality shows, often when you're watching, they kind of force you to reflect on what you might do in a similar situation. It kind of triggers a self-reflection on part of the viewer. So as a viewer, we're not a contestant in the show, but we almost feel like a participant of the show itself. I think that's why shows like Love is Blind really just like capture culture whenever it's on television, because we're all watching collectively together, and we're all asking, well, I would have done it this way, or, you know, I would have done it this way, or that happened to me, this is what I did. And so something about the genre of reality TV in general, but reality dating, kind of like puts you into the driver's seat as you're watching. And that's why there's so much debate and discussion with all of these shows.
Justine, why do you think people love judging other people's relationships and love choices?
I think that a lot of these dating shows are a mix between a social experiment and a game show. And I think that's why people enjoy judging them so harshly, is because they are currently being judged and they are currently up for debate. I think it's not dissimilar to, I always say this, how men watch sports. There's a lot of men who tell these people who are in much better shape than them to run the ball. And meanwhile, they are barely doing hitting 10 push-ups.
That
okay?
is true.
I think that the kind of like reputation of loving reality shows and loving reality dating shows is very much tainted because women are the audience, the main target.
Do you think it's more the judging, or do you think there is an element of people wanting the happily ever after? Like, is there any of that, or is it purely judging?
You know what? I think people are judging because they want the happily ever after. They're like, why are you doing that? You guys could be together forever if you just put your narcissism to the side. Like, okay. I think people are.
So the judging is coming from a good place. Okay.
I mean, I don't know. Some people who we watch, let's say, like Bartice from Love is Blind, for example, like, we don't really want to see him win very often. But then most people who we want to see them win. We want to see them fall in love, and we want to be there for the whole ride.
And what about you two? Like, what got you specifically interested into the reality dating genre? Like, were you going through things in your dating life, or was there another reason that you were drawn to it?
It's funny, because when we first started our podcast coming up on 6 years ago, we were both single, like single as a dollar bill, two besties running around New York, going out, like looking for our husbands. Like, that was like the space we were in when we started. And we started our podcast with The Bachelor, Bachelor, Bachelorette, Bachelor Nation. So that's kind of where we got our start. But beyond just Bachelor Nation, reality dating as a genre has really taken off. You'd see Netflix has invested heavily in this genre with Love is Blind and The Ultimatum. And it's not that we were going through anything specifically in our dating life that kind of like propelled us. We initially got our start because we were watching Rachel Lindsay's season of The Bachelorette. We're having a blast getting together, watching the show and chatting about it, and seeing this Black woman have her journey for love, but other podcasts and other commentaries, it felt like they were watching a different show than what we were watching. So we wanted to kind of bring our own specific lived experience as Black women dating and looking for love, and kind of talk about those challenges or tribulations, but also have fun watching the TV show. And then I think just over the years, like, reality dating as a genre has just really been heavily invested in. And, you know, shows like Love is Blind are global shows where now everyone is talking about it. And so it's giving us space to really add our voice to the conversation and just spark interesting conversation.
Justine, I'm curious to know from you, because these are reality shows. The word reality is in them, but we know, I have many friends who work in reality television. A lot of it is scripted. A lot of it is thrown in there by the producers. A lot of it is contrived, but there's still an element of reality somewhere, right? So where do you see the convergence between the shows and reality?
That's a good question. I think it would depend on the show. And I think it depends on what season the show is in. I think the earlier the show, the more authentic the cast.
I could see that.
Yes.
Right? We've seen that. Me and Natasha were just talking about how the state of Texas really doesn't need to be filmed any longer for reality television shows.
They're going through it.
They really need to just halt production on all reality dating shows in Texas, because it just is not. Married at First Sight was horrendous in Houston.
Interesting.
Love is Blind this season was the worst. So bad that I saw a Time magazine article about it. Like, it was bad.
Yeah.
Which I think is interesting, but I think that's one of the conversions, right? I think Love is Blind Dallas, when Bartice and Nancy had to talk about abortion in front of his entire family, that was reality.
Yep.
That's reality.
Right?
So I feel like what's coming to mind for me, do you remember that show Dating Around on Netflix?
Yes, we love Dating Around.
I feel like that one was like, okay, like, people love that show, but it was also like kind of banal at the same time, because like not much was happening.
Yeah.
And in my opinion, was it the best TV? I don't know. Until they like hit that point where there was conflict and people just erupted. But the everyday date was a little, you know, uneventful. But I think that one actually depicted reality probably more than others, because most dates are uneventful. Like, are there any other shows that you feel like you're like, oh, this actually could happen in dating?
Swiping America is a show that came on HBO. Yep. We recapped it a few months ago.
Yes.
That we often equated to dating around, actually, because it was very much showing just the banality and sometimes boringness of dating. Like, you're literally texting, you're swiping, you're having these conversations, you're talking with your friends. Like, very, very little producer intervention. They were literally just letting these people date. It was four New Yorkers. They were dating around the country, swiping at each city that they went to. And we really enjoyed it. We had great conversation that came from it because we weren't talking about made up drama. We were talking specifically about these people's like actual reality. But what I liked about it was it really captured just modern day dating right now, which is very much around swiping culture and dating apps and how to craft a message and showing it to your friend to kind of get help with the message, or he texted me this, what do I say? Like, a lot of those in and out, like small minutia moments that can maybe appear boring on television, but I found it really interesting to kind of see these people in their very natural habitat dating. So Swiping America definitely is one, I think, if you like dating around, to check that out.
Do you think there is anything about that show, like, let's say you're in the thick of dating, like, would you actually get insight that would help your dating life? Or is it more just showing what dating is like?
I think so. Like, on Swiping America, there was a woman, Reagan, who was cast on the show. I mean, I'm not currently swiping and looking for someone, but I felt like I could learn a lot from her and how she crafted her messages. I thought she was really interesting in how she, like, really showed her personality in getting conversations started with guys. If I was dating and swiping and watching the show, I would probably pick up some tips from her, just in terms of she was very much like a quirky kind of person, but she kept her expectations low, which I think is usually a good thing when you're out there swiping. And you could tell she was invested in just wanting to have a good conversation with someone, like not trying to make this man her husband, but let me just say something funny and see how he takes it. And I think kind of watching that approach was refreshing. I think people dating who are kind of feeling like the apps are getting stale or they're getting annoyed or whatever, even just watching her and her approach, you might learn a new approach and kind of like take it into your, you know, toolbox as you're swiping.
Well, that's so funny because that's like the exact opposite of Love is Blind, where you're like going to the altar
yeah.
and there's so much pressure.
Yeah.
Like when you're on an island, like there's so much about reality TV show that's so far from reality. Like on the flip side, like what would you say is stuff that maybe has been ingrained in us that's just not realistic at all?
I think the level of romance that you can get to as quickly as these people get to, I think it is outrageous that a lot of these girls on The Bachelor, particularly when The Bachelorette is the star, will say, he planned this for me. And it's so obvious.
That it's okay.
He literally doesn't even have like access to his bank account at the moment. He doesn't even have access to a phone to make a reservation. Like, this is so obvious that like this did not actually happen. And so I think those, even those little small narratives of like, I'm so happy he did this for me. That's not true. So I think that even when I'm watching and when we're recapping, I have to like take my blinders off for the podcast itself and be like, oh my God, no, that didn't happen. We don't know if he's that nice or
not. It's dangerous too. You're like, why is it my partner planning a hot air balloon for me?
And it's odd because every date is a grand gesture. They're sitting at a table in water and swans are swimming around. How many dates have you been on like that when you're in a relationship? Like, they don't show the moments of them sitting on the couch on a Sunday talking or like giving each other foot massages. We don't see any of that. I guess that's boring to watch on reality TV. That's so far from reality to me.
Yeah, I think the closer thing to reality is the smaller moments when you like snap when like for me, my moments are like, what do you want to eat? And he's like, huh, you know, I don't know, babe. What do you want to eat? And I want to choke him out. So those things to me like are funny and I think very relatable and I think would be a lot of fun to watch. But I am also somebody who would watch Dating Around, who would watch Living America. I like watching people live their everyday life. So I'm not the voice for these producers and everything. So
can you think of one show that is as far from reality as possible in the dating reality genre?
Every last one of them. Most of them are, though. I mean, I think just a lot of these producers are really just trying to find the straight RuPaul's Drag Race.
Yeah.
And they're trying to find whatever is going to create the same economy, fandom, and stardom that comes off of a show like Drag Race. And they like can't figure it out. And so they're trying all these extremes. And it's just not really working out. Like, I think Love is Blind got nominated for an Emmy last year.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely not this year. They are definitely out the running. So.
Well, if there's a show that comes to mind that's like really, really out there, and I actually really love this show. Last season was not the greatest, but Temptation Island. I don't know if you guys have watched that one.
Yes. Yeah.
Oh my God.
Uh-huh. Temptation Island is like a true social experiment, which is what makes it really interesting to watch. Because I mean, from the premise is ridiculous. Like, I don't know why anyone would sign up for this show to, you know, take their relationship of 10 years to Temptation Island, where he gets to now be in a house with single women. Like, I don't know why, like that within itself seems so unrealistic, but it is like a true social experiment, and it's very far from reality because that's not normal to like your person has like a hall pass and you also have a hall pass, and then at the end you're gonna see if it's gonna work out. It's like so outlandish, but on Temptation Island, when it works, it works. Like when at the end, when there's a couple that comes back together and they're like, this is what we needed. Like, I learned so much about myself. Like, I didn't make out with any girls. I just talked to them and I just learned about my feelings. Like, it's so stray far from reality. But then when it somehow comes together, you're like, oh, okay, there is kind of like a method to the madness, kind of, I guess.
I'm really glad we're talking about the ones that are like really far out, because I think most people can see like, okay, the odds of me being on some random remote island with all these strangers probably not gonna happen in our everyday dating lives. But I think a lot of these shows, there are messages that start to seep into dating culture, consciously or unconsciously. We want to go through a few of these with you and get your take on some of the stuff that we're seeing from reality TV that goes to dating culture. So the first one that we really see is this like pick me mentality. And I think the whole like Bachelor, like who's going to get the rose, who's going to progress to the next round. We see daters all the time being like, I need to get to date number two. I need to get to date number three, even at the detriment that they're like, do I even like this person? I've never stopped to ask myself. How do you see this pick me mentality going into dating culture?
I don't know if that's because of The Bachelor.
Okay.
I feel like that's overall, right?
Mm.
I would assume so. I think pick me has been around for a really long time. And I think that's like a patriarchal societal thing. I don't know if that's like spawned from rose ceremonies necessarily.
Maybe not started, but I think perpetuated like this feeling of like dating as a competition more.
Yeah. And I think like with the whole pick me mentality, at least how we see it displayed on reality dating shows, is just kind of the lack of like intentionality, like women wanting to be chosen, wanting to be picked, wanting to maybe beat out another girl, maybe to boost their own ego or feel good about themselves, but not really ever questioning if they even like the person. And I can see how that could appear in how this definitely does already appear, even without TV shows, in modern dating. There's sometimes an exhaustion that comes with dating just in general. And so sometimes you reach a point where you're like, I just want someone to choose me. I just want the guy that likes me, you know?
Right.
It's interesting. We're recapping Golden Bachelor right now, where there's a senior bachelor and a group of senior women. And last episode, a woman went home and her reason was like, you have your top and I'm not in the top and that's fine for me and I'm going to go. And we talked about it because that rarely ever happens on The Bachelor, Bachelorette. Like these girls are just trying to make it through the end. Like you can tell they don't have a connection with this dude, like but they want to be chosen and they also want to beat out the other girls and they want to be picked. And they're not really thinking like, I can also pick this guy. Like if I'm not feeling it, I can also go home. And I could see in modern dating how that appears as well.
Yeah. It's also, I get it. When you're in that environment where it's like, this is the last guy on earth. And you only have this guy to choose from. Right. You're like, I better start developing feelings for him because I have no other options. So he better pick me.
Yep.
The funny part is that we see daters do that when there are like thousands of options, right, on dating apps. But you get in your head like, this is the last person on earth. So it's kind of an interesting parallel.
And I think it's that exhaustion, too. Yeah. Like, you tell yourself, like, this better be the last one. This is the last guy. Like, I think you just get exhausted that you just, like, are done with trying to choose and weed through and just want somebody to finally end this chase and just pick you.
I'm curious, have you done an analysis on these dating shows where like the man picks a woman or the woman picks a man, the success rate post show. I was curious because I feel like the first 10 seasons of Bachelor versus Bachelorette, there was a stat that when the woman picks, the success rate is a lot lower than when the man picks. I don't know if you've ever looked at any of those numbers.
I was going to say, in Bachelor Nation, it's actually the reverse. The Bachelorette has more successful marriages.
Much higher success rate.
Yeah, than the Bachelor.
Oh.
And then there's also an Instagram account, Bachelor Data, who is a data scientist. And she does like extensive deep dive analyses into just like literally anything. Like if you get the first impression rose, like how long do you last? She does a lot of cross analysis, a lot of different data points, and has done a lot of comparison between the Bachelor and the Bachelorette. So when the man is booking versus one is the women. But in Bachelor Nation, the women leads.
Why do you think that is?
I think usually the women in the past couple of years that we've been watching the show have been older than the men have been. And I think that's a big part of it. I think that women don't get distracted nearly as easily as men do in this particular environment. And it's just like very obvious by everybody's last few episodes. Right? Like no woman bachelorette has topped Colton jumping a fence over the corner. Like that was outrageous. He went completely unhinged. And while we know now he was indeed unhinged.
Yep.
It's just something that like a woman, I think, can compose herself a little bit more in that environment than a man can. Mm-hmm.
I think the next one that I feel like is very prevalent in reality TV is like this marriage is the end goal. Like especially with the stakes, like, I mean, Love is Blind. I feel like even just getting into a relationship after not seeing someone for all that time would be normal. But having to propose and get married, mm-hmm. like, I feel like all this just perpetuates that. What's your take on that side of things?
Yeah.
The marriage is the end goal in these shows. It's what really makes it a social experiment. Definitely people in like outside of reality want to get married. I don't know if people are holding it as like, this is the ultimate holy grail. I can never be anything worthy unless I get married. But on the shows, they really just lean into it being a competition in some way, or really lean into it being an experiment, wanting to raise the stakes. And how do you do that? You give the ultimate prize at the end, which is marriage, which of course makes good TV, makes people go crazy like in the process. But I don't know if it's affecting us as we're approaching dating. I think it is, as I said, very individual. There's some people that just like marriage is their ultimate thing and they're going after it. And then some people who are kind of dating casually or dating for their own. Yeah, the marriage is the end goal is like a very interesting thing with these shows.
Yeah, I agree. And if I may just add really quickly that in America specifically, we don't have any like royalty. And I think people get obsessed with married couples because who are famous.
Ooh, that's interesting.
And elevated because we don't have a like royal family, royal couple to kind of like look towards or infantilize the same way that other countries do. That being said, married at first sight UK is like huge. Like Love is Blind UK is coming next season. Like it's nice. Not like exclusive, but I think that that's part of it is a lot of people hold up people like Lauren and Cameron from Love is Blind so highly because they're like the king and queen, right? We have like a lot of like prom king and queen BS that we kind of like throw around all the time around these reality shows. And I think that for a lot of people who go into these shows as cast members is the prize. I want to be the new Lauren and Cameron of this franchise and worshipped by a fandom.
Interesting.
Because that's better than $100,000 down the middle. I can tell you right now, Lauren and Cameron got way more than that. So I think that is part of it too.
Yeah. Because we grew up in a generation where we really don't have role models for good relationships. I mean, older generations are really fucked up. So we're like, somebody show us what a good relationship looks like. What you're saying about the royal family, that's super fascinating because we really don't have a North Star. So we keep wanting to fill that with these reality TV stars or celebrities and what they represent. But then people get butt hurt when they break up. There's just always like, oh my God, they're getting a divorce. Yeah. And then there's like the shock. And like, then you step back and you're like, are you really shocked that this didn't work out? Why are we so attached to their outcome?
Like, it's like the same thing, I think, with Will and Jada that's happening right now. I think the backlash that is on her is pretty strong because none of us want to be in this conversation. We all wanted to, as one of our Facebook members said, exit out the group chat, we didn't really want to be in this, and now we're in it. But they were one of those pinnacle couples, and they were a Black couple who had immense success across racial lines, right? Like, for Jada Pinkett and Will both to be famous and not just Black famous is a huge deal. And to still be married after 26 years or however long is a huge deal. And for them to just say, oh, you know what? That was all fake for the past 6 years and buy my book is very hurtful to people.
Yeah. Let's hold that thought for a quick message.
Our Finding Your Person program is open for registration right now. Are you ready to cut through the BS of modern dating and find your person already? We sure felt that way when we developed the Finding Your Person program. The endless swiping and bad dating behavior can really take a toll on your outlook. And do you ever feel like you have every other aspect of your life figured out except for your love life? That's why we have relaunched the Finding Your Person program that has previously sold out time and time again. And by talking to thousands of daters over the last 7+ years, we've been able to pinpoint exactly what helps people find their person. Registration is open right now, but it's not going to stay open for too much longer. We're closing it December 3rd or when we reach full capacity, whichever comes first. So get on it now. Spots are limited. Go to findingyourperson.com to sign up. Again, that's findingyourperson.com. This episode is sponsored by Oncommon Goods. It's officially time to kickstart your holiday shopping, but there's no cause for panic. Oncommon Goods is here to make your holiday shopping stress-free by scouring the globe for the most remarkable and truly unique gifts for everyone on your list. Whether you're shopping for mom, dad, teenagers, in-laws, or your best friends, Oncommon Goods knows exactly what they want. You may remember, my parents love national parks, and I found them each a national parks checklist shirt that they can actually check off every park they visited, right on the shirt. What a neat idea. When you shop at Oncommon Goods, you're supporting artists and small independent businesses. These fine products are often made in small batches. So shop now before they sell out this holiday season. To get 15% off your next gift, go to oncommongoods.com/dateable. That's oncommongoods.com/dateable for 15% off. Don't miss out on this limited time offer. Oncommon Goods, we're all out of the ordinary.
Well, there is this weird thing. I know, like, Natasha, you betcha, not everyone has marriage as the end goal. And I totally agree with that. Mm-hmm. But there is this weird piece of society that has, even though it's outdated, like, hasn't caught up yet to that. That's like, if you're married, then you're winning. Like, you are, you know, killing it at life. And if you are single, you are the loser. And there is like this mentality that keeps perpetuating through all of this. And it's interesting, like when I'm watching these shows with my partner, he's always like, who's winning? And I'm like, this is Love is Blind. Like, they're not in competition with each other. But people do see, you know, like, I think like, it's like the couples that end up at the altar saying yes, there is this like subconscious of like, this person won the show, even though they're not really, because they're the ones that made it to the marriage track.
Yeah. I think we don't have enough conversation around like being single and single being a beautiful possibility, a beautiful choice for some people.
Yeah.
We're always talking about it in a very negative space. You're single now, but you know, there's something good coming for you on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's where that tension comes in, because we're not really having a conversation about singleness and singledom in a positive light and as a potential choice that you can also make.
Yeah.
Or a possibility that you can also find beauty in and self-love, or still have relationships with people, you know, it just might look different, might not be in a monogamous, like heteronormative sense. And so I think that's where I was having a conversation with a friend actually this week, who I always say she's like my one friend who she's single. She's like single and chilling. Like, I've never seen someone so just like content in her singleness. Yeah. And it's beautiful, but it seems odd because usually they're like single and like riled up and like trying to find Yeah. And she's really just like single and chilling. And she's been kind of toying with the idea of like, is marriage for her? Does she want to be married? Like, I really admire her because she's been having this conversation with herself around singleness being a option. And it is an option. You know, you can weigh both. You can weigh being with a partner and having a life partner, and you can weigh the option of just wanting to be with yourself. And I don't think most people have that conversation with themselves.
Yeah.
So that's why she was kind of struggling to figure out, I don't even know who to talk to about this because no one has had this viewpoint of singleness. And so she really just kind of pointed that out to me, that it's a possibility and it can be a choice and it can be a beautiful one. And we should probably talk more about it.
Well, I think that's what one of the best moments on Love is Blind, for me at least, was when Deep T chose herself. I think a lot of people really resonated with that. And it's what you were just saying, Natasha. It's like there was this feeling of like she is actually better off alone. And like, can we celebrate that? So yes. Glad that that came through, even though marriage was still the goal in that show. I'm glad she was able to like break through. And I think that resonated with a lot of people.
Yeah, I think Deep, that's a great example of a moment where we were all happy
for
the marriage and the end goal to not come to fruition. It'd be nice to have more moments like that celebrated and even seen.
Well, because for a reality TV show, you need an objective. But if you just have a bunch of single and happy people, there's no objective. They're just
it's not interesting.
Doing life, you know, living their best lives. So it's not as interesting to, I wonder if there is a way to do that. But the flip side of that idea is my favorite show, Bachelor in Paradise, which I think is like one of the most toxic shows on television. But how ridiculous is it? It's all these people getting together, trying to form connections. And the only way to stay on the island is if you're coupled up. So they manipulate each other and they feel safe once they get the rose and then they get to advance to the next round. But you never know who's coming down the stairs and that person could pull you away any day because all connections are threatened every single day. That gives me so much anxiety to think about. It's like, oh my gosh, is that how reality is? Is that how single life is? It's like every day you're looking for someone to save you so you can live to the next day. So you stay alive?
When you break it down like that, it is very similar to dating. Like you go on a date with a guy, it's going well, and you went home and went back on the apps, and you know he went back home and went on the apps. And so you're hoping he doesn't find somebody good. You're hoping he calls you, hoping nobody comes down to the beach and steals you away. It's like very, very similar, I would say. I've never thought of paradise in that way, but it is,
Yeah.
It's really messed up when you think about it.
It is. Messed
up. I think the other part that's so messed up to me is just like what the definition of dateable is. Like, this is another topic I want to get your take on, like on these shows. Like, I feel like Love is Blind is a perfect example. Like, the whole point is, are these people going to fall in love with these people that they don't know what they look like? But then all of them are like gorgeous. Like, no one on that show. Yeah, exactly. And I'm like, this does not actually hit this experiment. And then I think actually you guys said it, like there's no one on The Bachelor that's like over a size 6. Is that accurate? Like something like that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
No body diversity.
Yeah.
And I feel like Golden Bachelor is like the first instance now where we're actually seeing like older people. Like in other shows too, they've tried to hide the ages. Like Ultimatum, it came out that all these people were like in their 30s and they like changed their age to be in their 20s. So yeah, it's just like perpetuating a lot of these stereotypes. I'm curious what your takes are on that.
I think it just shows the hatred that the entertainment industry has for body diversity and for diversity as a whole. I think we went through a lot of fakery in the most recent years as millennials, especially through the media space. We're having a great moment for Black media isolated, right? We have Insecure, we have Abbott Elementary, we have all kinds of shows that are coming out that are all just in their own corner, run by very specific people, and they're over there where everybody can watch them. But I think when it comes to reality dating, there's some things that have to be faced, right? Like Rachel Lindsay had a racist on her show and they cast him because they thought it would be fun. That's a huge issue. I don't know, but I feel like whoever made that decision probably still works there. So I think we can be very isolated, despite the fact that our worlds have gotten so much bigger with social media and with media in general. But I think that overall, we want to watch pretty people run around, shop, and fall in love and go on dates. And that's it.
When you ask the question about dateable, like who's dateable or what are these shows telling us about that conversation? I thought of this season with Love is Blind with Johnny. She was the lawyer who had what she was calling 8,000 red flags with her past. And that was her narrative that she was perpetuating, that she's a mess and her past ex was an addict and she was married before and blah, blah, blah. And I think her conversation or it just brought up a conversation about like baggage, how much baggage is appropriate. You know, should Johnny have been cast on the show? Is that too much baggage? Is she dateable? It brought a lot of conversation around that. And people are in varying degrees of that. There's people who related to Johnny and they don't want to be told that they're not dateable. Like, she deserves to be there looking for love too, right? But then there's people who are like, well, no, because Izzy, you know, he had every right to, you know, decide not to go with her because it might be too much for him, and that's fine for him to make that decision. So I think it is interesting with the show casting people that have a diversity of dating backgrounds for us to all kind of collectively ask, like, what's dateable for you? Where would you draw your lines? Who's a dateable option for you? And it's going to vary per person, but it is interesting for us to like reflect on that when we watch through these characters.
And I'm glad that industry is changing, even though it's slow. It's changing. I mean, with Golden Bachelor, you know that they're like, okay, our franchise is kind of dying right now. We can't have the same white guy every season. We got to change it up. Let's just make the white guy old. At least that's something. That's like some sort of progress there.
Some innovation, yes.
It's something. And for so long, I felt like they were just creating the same characters and just putting a different color on them. Like every Asian girl I saw on these reality TV shows, I'm like, that's just the same white girl, but just Asian. Is like,
yeah,
different color. But I'm starting to see the variation. It's coming because I think as an audience, it is our responsibility to reflect feedback by watching or not watching. I stopped watching The Bachelor because I was so sick of seeing the same faces, the same bodies from season to season. And the networks are picking up on that. Are you also seeing these changes? And what other areas are you seeing that other than body diversity and ethnic diversity?
Yeah, I think progress is definitely slow in the Bachelor Nation realm. We saw them cast Matt James as the first Black Bachelor. That was a hot mess of a season. We're seeing now Gary, the Golden Bachelor. People are loving it. I'm loving it. I'm having a blast watching this season. So I think they're kind of slowly but surely kind of trying to innovate, but also not alienate their very like white female middle America audience. I think that's what's happening in Bachelor Nation. But thankfully, outside of that, one of our favorite shows this past year was The Ultimatum, Queer Love.
Yes.
I thought it was so good. The casting was done so well in casting these couples that were a bit older, that had more mature relationships, also exposing viewers to communities of people that they might not otherwise have much exposure to, brought a lot of great conversation. And that's a Netflix show. So we saw that Netflix is at least trying to kind of open up conversation of diversity there. And I think another show that Justine and I really love, Couples Therapy. You guys watch that?
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Such a good show.
Fantastic show.
So good.
And yeah, really every season we've seen, it's just like the full gamut of relationships. I mean, we've seen interracial couples. We've seen queer couples. We've seen a couple between a trans woman and a man, I think. Again, just gives viewers exposure to communities we might not see. So there's other shows that are doing the work. There's other shows that are at least dabbling with for the sake of trying to attract more viewers, and just better conversation is not just showing us the same, you know, white man, white woman that we've been seeing for years on let's say The Bachelor, for instance.
Yeah, I'm really glad that this progress is happening. Like, do you see this seeping into people's self-views or views around dating? Like, you kind of alluded to this a little, Natasha, like the people that are saying like, oh, is Johnny not dateable because she has quote unquote baggage? Do you see that happening and that evolving with these changes? Or do you think people are able to like separate and just be like, this is media being media?
I don't think media has done that good of a job yet. To have people who are marginalized see themselves in the people in media, I don't think we're there yet. I'm not going to give them that much credit. I think it takes a little bit more work than what we've seen.
Another show I was just thinking about is like Indian Matchmaking. And
such a good show.
Yeah, great show. And just kind of seeing Auntie Seema, who's this very
polarizing
is the word.
Character.
And her flat out saying to people like, you're not dateable, or flat out saying like that you got to lower your standards. Like, even just seeing that has been very stark. But that's brought great conversation, I think, and has us questioning for ourselves as viewers. Like, what are we acceptable with? What are the standards we want to set? Not based on what Auntie Seema or what the media is telling us, but it has us question our own kind of standards and method of dating for ourselves.
Yeah. There are some moments. I still will say there are some moments. I think short kings are having a moment. I think women need to get over the height thing in general, yeah. But I think the media is starting to get there. I just find this so interesting. Attraction is reflected back to us from what we see on TV. Yeah. So the more we see of a certain type, the more we are attracted to that. The more we see the short kings on TV mm-hmm. being picked by these women, the more we will see that on dating apps and be like, oh, 5'5". Yeah. That's good for me, right? So I think that does bleed into society eventually. If there is a lag, it will take some time. We yeah. might not see in our generation for all the changes, but at least we're making yeah. some sort of change there.
I will say Asian men have mm-hmm. definitely had.
Oh, yes.
For a long time.
That's a good
time.
Example.
And I have said on our podcast, I'm like, we were missing out on all these fine ass men just because mm-hmm. you all had like a subscription right. that Asian men mm-hmm. were not attractive to uh-huh. the grand scheme of everybody. I think that is crazy. Crazy.
It is crazy that like we need media to like tell us. Like, I'm not saying like we do it consciously, but it is right. kind of fucked up when you think about it.
It's their yeah. job. It's their job. Yes. And they have a very important job and they know it. And that's why I'm very reluctant to give them credit yeah. because they know exactly what they're doing.
So here's another one that kills me is Fuckboy Island. Okay. Like, I feel like it perpetuates this thing that there's nice guys and fuckboys. And we've heard this like for listeners and people that have written in, it's like, I don't want to settle for the nice guy. So then they end up with like the situationship that doesn't give a fuck about them. But there's like so mm-hmm. much in the middle. Like, you can find such a great person that doesn't need to be like the nice, stereotypical, boring person versus like the fuckboy. What's your take on like those two like parameters and like polarities and how much they are emphasized?
Fuckboy Island is such a fun one because they really lean into like the polarizingness of the yeah. F-boy mm-hmm. and the nice guy, because we all know like nice guys are also fuckboys. You know, like we yeah. also know that there's a lot of gray area there for sure. Another thing that came to mind, we just watched this on Love is Blind actually with Chris, who ended yeah. up oh, with yeah. Johnny in the end.
Yeah.
We were literally calling him like Sweet Cherub Chris during our recaps. Ah. And then he just like blew everyone away during the reunion when mm-hmm. he turned out to be a fuckboy. And even just watching him, that created a lot of conversation as to like, there's no nice guys. Like, everybody has the potential to be an F-boy. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think it's just allowing us women to kind of commiserate. That's kind of why I love F-Boy Island with Nikki Glaser. Like, her whole job as the host is to just roast these guys like the whole time. Yeah. Totally. And yeah, put them in their place and, you know, empower the women there. We're watching, you know, three leads kind of really have the power of trying to like cut through these F-boys. And so I think it makes it a fun watch for women who are on an everyday basis dealing with trying to decipher if the guy that they're talking to is actually a quote unquote nice guy, which maybe that's not the right term, but if yeah. he is going to just show up and be exactly who he presents or not. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if anything, for F-Boy Island, I think I just love that piece of it, just the commiseration that it allows us all women to kind of like lead into.
It's true. That's such a great show. So funny. Like, so bad, but it's so funny as well. Personal question for both of you. You're both in relationships. What is the appeal of dating shows? Why is this still so interesting to you to pick apart single people?
It's not even about picking apart single people. I mean, the road to find my husband was like a long, treacherous road. Like, I spent, we met on Hinge. I like deep in the online dating space for the 5-6 years I was dating and, you know, living in New York. And I learned a lot about myself through the dating process. And my husband is like my first real relationship worth noting, you know, and I've yeah. learned so much about relationships and communication stuff through him, but also giving myself a lot of credit of what I brought in based on all the self-work that I did with dating and being with myself. And I don't know, I've just always been interested in the concepts of dating and relationships and how people show up for each other. And with online dating, a lot of like peacocking and presentation we have to do to kind of like get people to notice us. And I'm in a group text with a bunch of my single friends. I'm like the only one in a relationship in that text. And it's just them back and forth, just sharing like insights on dates they've been on or screenshots of things. And just the sisterhood even that is surrounded by us trying to find our life partner together and what I'm learning and what you learn, girl, and us kind of like sharing and not having to feel so alone in doing it is why even now that I'm married, I enjoy talking about dating. I enjoy talking with my friends about dating. I enjoy watching relationships play out on television and seeing what I can learn from them or what we can take away from them. And I think these shows really spark such interesting conversations.
Yeah.
Again, even with the Indian matchmaking, as I said, Auntie Seema's whole like 60%, you can only expect 60 or 70% out of a man. Like, we had a really deep conversation about, is there some truth in that? Or is she all the way wrong? And it really forces you to reflect in a way that television doesn't always. Sometimes it just serves as pure entertainment. But I think reality does have that ability to really make you reflect and relate it back to your life, your friends, and kind of like make it more of like a communal thing. Because dating solo, dating on your own can be very exhausting and scary and annoying and all those feelings. So why do it alone? Do it while watching TV with somebody or do it in the group text with your friends.
Yeah, I think the same. I love all reality shows. I'm a huge Real Housewives fan, but I also love kind of more intellectual deep dives like couples therapy. Couples therapy is really, I'd be like yelling at the TV, like how men yell at the TV on Super Bowl. Like, I really am into that show. And part of it is that I just really like the human experience and watching it. I'm a huge extrovert. I have lots and lots of friends. I also currently live by myself. And so I enjoy watching reality TV shows for those reasons as well. And I think like Natasha said and has said on our podcast too, everybody is either looking for love in their life or has love in their life in some way. And the best part of these shows is when all the wives get together and talk about the husbands, when all the husbands get together and they talk about the wives. That's part of the best nugget of the show come out of those conversations. So it's not necessarily just about us like coming in as people in relationships and shitting on single people. That's definitely not the goal of what we're trying to do. I hope that that's not what we come off as. But it really is just us looking at how people are navigating through relationships where in a country, in a time, in a kind of place where it's really hard to navigate those relationships these days. People don't leave you anymore the same way that they left you. You can just keep up with people if you want to. You can always find someone if you want to. That is crazy. We're all adapting to that now. And our parents can't give us advice on that stuff. So we have to do things like watch reality TV and figure out, okay, when do I block this part? Like, when is it really time to like to really take it there? So part of it is that we're navigating issues that our parents can't give us advice on. We have to learn from each other on these things.
Yeah, it's really interesting because we kind of started this whole thing about how like reality TV, there's a lot of like judgment that's like brings us together to like look at others and how they're doing things. But I like this positive spin on like reflecting a bit more. Like, what else do you think that people can take away from reality TV shows that actually like help them with their own dating lives and enhance their love lives?
I think finding kind of solace in acknowledging and seeing that dating is difficult. You're not alone in that moment of the month where you're like, I just want to get off the apps. Like, we all, whether you're on the apps or not, you see it on TV. Dating is just hard to find your person, to find, especially if you believe in monogamy, you're one person out of the 9 billion people on this planet. Like, it's hard. And it's okay if you want to like take a break from the apps for a second and just lean into TV and see somebody else struggling and just like take on their struggle instead of your own. As I said, like this, what I really enjoy about my group test is like the sister of us trying to make this thing fun.
Yeah.
I think even on our podcast, like we definitely have a lot of deep nuanced conversations around dating, but at the end of it, we really are just having fun, just like watching these people kind of navigate a journey that we both navigated as well and know very well, you know, being single out here in these streets trying to find our husbands. So I think that's what they can take away, which is maybe like a very cliche answer, but it's true. Dating is tough. It is tough to find your person. It's difficult, and it's okay to like try to find some joy joy and humor in it. And these shows can bring a lot of that to you. It can make it a little less scary and down in the doldrums when you can just watch, you know, some F-boys in F-boy Island get roasted by Nikki Glaser. Like, I mean, just bring some joy to it, you know?
Yeah, I mean, this has been such a great conversation. I mean, I think the biggest takeaway I have from all of this is reality TV at the end of the day is still entertainment. It can be a way to open up conversations, mm-hmm. but the more we can remember that it's set up in a certain way, this isn't like going to seep into our dating lives, and probably like anything you learn from there, like at surface level face value, deserves to be dove into instead of just being like, oh yeah, like I meet my person and 6 weeks later, I'm going to get married. Like, clearly, like, that's not the way the world works. And like, we can't take this stuff that's happening on TV and expect like, oh, I'm just going to have this instant chemistry and like get whisked away on a hot air balloon. Like some of the stuff we were talking about at the top of like the expectations it's setting, like we have to remember that that's not reality. But this part about using it to dig deeper, I think that's really rich. And how do you, instead of being like in a judgment zone, like I feel like I'm guilty of this. Like I remember I like made fun of Amber from season one of Love is Blind because she snorted. And my partner's like, you do that too. Like who cares, you know? And I feel like we can get all high and mighty, you know? Yes. We can get all
exactly.
Yeah. And it's like, no one is perfect. Including yourself, like these people are just putting themselves out there. It's like, how, instead of picking them apart, can you use this to learn and have discussions with your friends? I love that. Or to listen to your podcast or to dive in deeper in this topic. That's what I think actually reality TV is here for, not for some of the stuff historically that we've thought it's here for.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Use it to reflect. Use it as a tool for reflection and conversation with yourself or with others. That's the most expectation you can have on it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And take it with a grain of salt, because we also have to understand it's a certain personality who would sign up for reality TV, and it's not everyone.
Honestly.
So we're only seeing one side of humanity. It's not the whole picture. My other takeaway is I feel like reality TV can be like art. It's not what you interpret, it's what your reaction is to it. And everybody can have a different reaction. And which is why I love your podcast, because you bring yourself into the show. It's like, why did I react that way when these two didn't work out? Or why did I react this way when he said this one thing? So we don't project our feelings onto other people and the characters we're watching. It's more like, oh, I'm seeing this reflected back at me. And this is really getting to me. And I want to be more curious about why that is. And it goes into, Julie, what you were saying about getting deeper with this and really reflecting on why does this show even matter?
My final thought, too, is I'm really glad, like, from this conversation, though, that we are seeing changes in reality TV, like in the demographics that it's part of and what's showcasing, because it is kind of on us to, as society, to not accept what entertainment gives us, but to also get into entertainment's air a little and be like, no, this is actually reality.
Yeah, make demands.
Exactly. What we wanna see. Yeah, it might not happen overnight, but I'm glad that we like address that shift is happening.
So love this conversation. Ladies, if people want to hear your podcast, learn more about each of you, where can they go? Give us all the links.
We're currently covering F-Boy Island season 3. Yeah. Really fun. You can listen to those episodes on all podcast platforms. And then we also have a Patreon where we cover Golden Bachelor, Bachelor in Paradise right now on patreon.com/2blackgirls1rose. And yeah, you can listen to us everywhere. We just wrapped up Love is Blind. We've done Married at First Sight, Swiping America, Queer Love. So if you eat up all those Netflix reality dating shows, we've probably done them. Just look into the archive and you can find some episodes. And yeah, find us on Instagram. 2 Black Girls 1 Rose, TikTok, all the places.
So grateful to have you two on our show. We're so grateful to eventually be on your show. We'll talk about Fuckboy Island or whatever it may be. We'll figure it out.
Yeah, it's gonna be fun.
And to all of our listeners at home, what did you learn from this conversation? Why don't you leave us and 2 Black Girls 1 Rose a rating and review in Apple Podcasts? 5 stars for both podcasts, please. And in the body of the review, give each of us something you learned from this episode. Maybe that you learned that there's a show called Fuckboy Island. That may be a learning for you. Or something deeper. So thank you all for being along for the ride, and we're gonna wrap up this episode.
Stay Dateable.
The Dateable podcast is part of the Frolic Media Network. Find more podcasts you'll love at frolic.media/podcasts. You can follow us on Instagram at Dateable Podcast and visit datablepodcast.com for access to all the episodes and our premium programs. Also, make sure to subscribe today if you haven't already on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or your favorite podcast platform so you are the first to get all the latest episodes. And most importantly, stay dateable.